The United States taxpayers are spending $2 billion every week in Afghanistan to maintain the military presence and the economic aid in Afghanistan. Tell our viewers why you think that is worth the money for American taxpayers.
First of all, I think for the last 10 years, just see the 10 years on, Afghanistan, because of the help, the money and sacrifice of the United States, has making tremendous progress. You know, Afghanistan of today is a democratic country. We have, for the first time in our history, the woman right and human rights and everything, and the freedom of the press, democracy, but also millions of our children are going to schools, 7 million, never in our history, 45 to 50% of them are girls. You have built, with your help, as much as roads, paved roads, never in our history we have done it. We have the basic health care cover about 60% of Afghanistan. But at the same time, I think we have defeated Al-Qaeda and Taliban militarily. And I think we have protected together with our sacrifices, not only built Afghanistan, but also the security of the United States.
But it looks like the security situation, at least to those of us from the outside, is getting worse in Afghanistan, not better, with all of these blatant, brutal attacks that we've seen unfold in Kabul, at the U.S. Embassy, at some of the big hotels there. It looks like the situation is getting worse, not better.
Look, Wolf, if you look to military thinking, I think militarily the Taliban and co. has been defeated. Now they are having access to spectacular act of suicide bombing, assassination of personality, and spectacular attacks. These attacks are planned outside Afghanistan in the sanctuaries that are not in Afghanistan, and we are working to that. So I think that is a sign of despair that you are doing it. But overall, security is better. Militarily, it has been defeated, and they are having now appealing to this kind of spectacular attacks.
How much longer do you think U.S. assistance, U.S. troops are needed? In other words, when will Afghan military and security personnel, after 10 years of this U.S.-led operation, when will your forces be able to get the job done by themselves?
That has been decided, Wolf. By the end of 2014, the transition will be completed. The Afghan National Security Forces will be fully in charge of security of Afghanistan. The first tranche of this transition has been completed, and we are working hard to complete it by the end of 2014. But, of course, in order to achieve that, we need a continued help of the United States in training and equipping of our national security forces, which is underway very positively. And we hope that by the end of 2014, Afghanistan National Security Forces will be fully in charge of security of Afghanistan.
As you know, there's a lot of pressure to pull out because of the money that U.S. is spending. What if the U.S. simply was involved in helping to train your forces, but the bulk of those 100,000 troops left tomorrow? What would happen in Afghanistan?
I think the plan is not the bulk will leave tomorrow. It's a plan decided in Lisbon Conference that by the end of 2014, gradually this force will be reduced. At the same time, the number of Afghan national security will be increased in training and in equipping.
Let me interrupt for a second, Foreign Minister. I understand that, but I'm asking a hypothetical question. What if there were a change in the U.S. policy and all U.S. troops, for practical purposes, were to immediately leave Afghanistan? What would happen?
That will create a very, very dangerous situation because the Afghan National Security Forces, despite the lot of progress that have been made, is not yet fully equipped and trained to take the full responsibility. And I think that will be a very difficult situation.
Do you believe